In the last video, we took a look at what is probably the simplest possible economy, and it's not even clear that this economy is even possible, this one-person economy. But to make it more analogous to the real world, where we have households and we have firms, in this one island, this guy set up a firm, and he essentially leased out all of the factors of production to that firm, including his own labor. He leased it out. The rent on his labor is essentially his wages. And then he bought all of the goods and services he needed from that same firm. So his payments would, his expenditures would be the revenue of that firm, and then the revenue of that firm would be turned into the expenses and the profit of the firm. So whatever the revenue wasn't used in expenses ended up being profit, and then all of that went back to that one household as income. And when we talked about how would we measure the economic activity in this island right over here, how would we measure its gross domestic product? We said, well, look, we could measure it in multiple different ways. We could, as it's leaving his hands, the dollars, and it's going to the firm, you could view it as the total expenditures. Or as it's approaching the firm, that's the same thing as the total revenue for this firm, total revenue for this simplified one firm economy. And that total revenue is the same thing as the total expenses plus the profit for that firm, and that's the same thing as this one household's income. And so let me write this down. The way we looked at it in the last video, that very simple example, GDP, was equal to household expenditures, which was equal to firm revenues, which was equal to firm expenses plus profit, which is equal to household income. I'll just write INC for income. Household income. And of course, household income is then, at least in this case right over here, it ended up being equal to household expenses. What I want to do in this video now is think about it in more general terms. Let's extend it to a more complex economy, to the world we live in. And with that, I want to look at the more formal definition for GDP. So this is the more formal definition of GDP, or I guess say the definition of GDP, and it's the market value of all final goods and services. And we're going to talk about what each of these things mean, of all final goods and services. I'll underline all separately. All final goods and services, let me do that in a different color. All final goods and services produced within a country in a given period. So you could have a GDP for a month, you could have a GDP for a quarter of a year, which would be 3 months, or you could have the GDP in a given year. And I guess you could even have GDP over a 10-year period. But it tends to be, we always think of GDP in terms of annual GDP or quarterly GDP, or sometimes even, so there's some estimates of even monthly GDP, but it tends to be annually or quarterly. But let's parse it a little bit more, because these little terms can be interesting. So the first one I'd like to parse is the idea of market value. Market value. What this is saying is, well, we need some way to measure what we've produced. And the best way we can do it is say, well, how much benefit are people getting it? And what they're willing to pay for it in the market is the best way that we can measure how much benefit they're actually getting out of it. So for example, if an avocado is produced in some farm, and also an orange is produced, we won't say that for each of these, we won't say, oh, GDP has increased by one fruit. We'd look at the market value for it. So if the market value of this avocado is $1 and the market value of this orange is 50 cents, then by producing this fruit, the GDP has increased by 50 cents. By producing this avocado, its GDP has increased by $1. Now in the next year, maybe there's whatever, demand for avocados goes down or whatever, and people pay less for it, and the market value of this of an incremental avocado is 50 cents. Then in the next year, even though the actual number of fruit that was produced is the same as the previous year, now all of a sudden the contribution from avocados might be the same as the contribution from oranges. So it really depends on the market value. And then we can focus on this all, the market value of all goods and services. All goods and services. So we would do all the different avocados and oranges, but we would do computers, we would do cars, we would do tires. And we're doing services. So if you have help at home, if you go to the doctor, the market value of all of those things are going to be put into GDP. Now, this won't include some things. So this does not include illegal things. If someone sells someone else drugs, we're not keeping track of it. Some would argue that maybe it should be kept track of in some way, that you have kind of this black market in things, but you're not keeping track of illegal activity. And you're also not keeping track of goods and services that are produced within the household and consumed within the household. So for example, if you hire an outside person to babysit your child, that would be considered part of GDP. That is a service that you are paying for. But if you yourself are babysitting your children, that is not going to be considered in GDP. If I start a lawn mowing business and I go mow other people's lawns, or maybe before my wife and I were dating, she used to pay me to mow my lawns. Then it would be included in GDP, but maybe once we get married, I just mow her lawn because we're the same family now, then it will not be included in GDP. But all does include pretty much everything that can be tracked, anything where someone there's an exchange of money, there's some payment between two parties for that good or service. Now, a really interesting thing, and this is something that I used to find confusing when I first got exposed to GDP, is the whole notion of final goods and services. And to understand this, let's think about how genes might be produced. So you have a cotton farmer, and there's some service that needs to be performed. So whatever, you know, some farming, some labor that needs to be performed. And let's say that is $5 of labor. And let's say that some land has to be rented. So let's say that is $5 of, well, I'll just make it a different number, $4 of land. $4 of land. And there are other inputs, but we don't have to go into all the details. And with that, and there's going to be some electricity and things like that, but we won't count all of it, you can produce some cotton, just the plant cotton. You can produce some cotton, some raw cotton. And that raw cotton is worth, the market value of that raw cotton is worth, let's say it's worth $10. So it's $10 worth of raw cotton. And then you could take that raw cotton, and you could combine it with some more labor. So let's say you combine that with another, I don't know, $6 of labor. $6 of labor, and it would also probably require some machinery and electricity and things like that. But I won't factor all of those things in just now. We don't need them to kind of get the point across. And if I do that, if I combine the $10, this kind of intermediate good, with the $6 of labor, then all of a sudden I can produce cotton thread. I can produce cotton thread. And that cotton, and the worth of the market value of that cotton thread, let's say, is now $20. And maybe there's another intermediate good there. Maybe it's some dye. We'll put the dye in later. Let's do the dye in later. So I have a $20 thread. And let's say I could take that $20 thread. Let me stay with white just because I started there. I could take that $20 thread and I could put in some more labor. Maybe I could take $10 of labor. And then I could create $30 worth of cotton fabric. And then I could take that $30 worth of cotton fabric plus some more labor. So let's say another $5 of labor. And let's say we also are going to put in $1 of dye right over here. And in the process, I can create the market value, let's say this is $50 worth of blue jeans. $50 worth of blue jeans. And I do this all over the course of the year. So the period in question. So the period for this one, I'll assume the period is a year. So it's all happening over the course of the period in question. So maybe it's happening, we're talking about the GDP in 2012. This is all happening in 2012. So what would be the contribution to GDP? If we didn't have the word final here, we just said the market value of all goods and services, then we would add this $5 to this $4 to this $10 to this $6. And we would, because of the production of this genes, we would get a very, very large number, a very, very large contribution to GDP. But that would be not even double counting, that would be triple or quadrupling or quintuple counting the value that's actually being created. Because all of this value is essentially being accounted for in this end $50. So the actual contribution to GDP, you would only put the final good. So you wouldn't include all of these other intermediary goods and services. You would just say this whole chain of event results in a $50 increase in GDP. And in another video, we'll talk about, well, what happens if they don't get to this point during the course of the year, if we kind of stop at one of the intermediary goods. But assuming you get to this point, you just include the final good in GDP. Now, this last part of it is produced within a country. Produced within a country. And this is, you know, you might have heard GNP, gross national product, and that's the main difference. GDP says, let's say we're talking about the United States, so that's my best attempt at drawing the United States. GDP says, look, if it was produced inside the country, we don't care who it was produced by. It could have been produced by someone from Mexico. It could have been produced by someone from Canada. It could have been a factory that's owned by the Chinese. But if it was produced within the borders of the United States, it gets counted as GDP. If an American, who's an American national, goes overseas and produces something, that is not counted as GDP. If an American owns a firm in another country and that firm in the other country produces something, that is not GDP. When you focus on people's nationality, that is GNP. So not to confuse things, but if you wanted to focus on GNP, then you do care about the earnings of American nationals. And so you wouldn't count the Canadian, but you would include the American who's making money overseas. So GDP, fairly simple idea. You say, what's being produced within these boundaries? We don't care who's doing the producing and what their actual nationality is, and we're going to ignore production by that nationality outside of these borders.